it's a contender with movies and beautiful things. And some? Okay, are you going to talk about the reliability of the diagnosis from Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents in surface marine flow? This work was made with Cristóbal López and Emilio Hernández from here. Also with Antonio Turiel from Barcelona, the ECF. The talk is divided in three parts. In the first part, I introduce some concepts and tools in order to understand why can I use the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents to analyze transport and emission. In the second part, I apply the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents at three different spatial scales. And coastal scales, and global scale, and mesoscale. In the third part, I analyze the scale properties of Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents and the robustness of the FSLE. Okay, let's start with the introduction. When we study fluids, we have two descriptions, Eulerian and Lagrangian description. In the Eulerian description, one is at any time, any space, spatial point with the velocity field, snapshot of the velocity field. And in the Lagrangian description, one deals with the trajectory of its particles. The Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent is a Lagrangian measure, so we use the Lagrangian description. Here is the connection between the Eulerian and Lagrangian description, is the snapshot of the velocity, and the integration of the particle is the we get the trajectory. It is known from the dynamical system theory that we can understand the global flow geometry by studying the invariant manifold of the fixed point. The fixed points are the points where the this is for the time-independent system, when the velocity is independent on time. In this system, the fixed point are the point where the velocity is equal to zero, and the steady manifold of fixed point is are all trajectories asymptote the fixed point when time goes to infinity. And the unstable manifold of the fixed point are all trajectories asymptote the fixed point when time goes to minus infinity. These manifolds separate distinct regions of motion. For example, in the pendulum, in the frictionless pendulum, we see in the fixed space in blue lines the invariant manifolds. Inside of these manifolds, the pendulum far and back continually like this, and outside this invariant manifold, the pendulum continually spin in one direction. So these manifolds separate the different regions of motion. So the marine flows are a time-dependent system, because now the velocity depends on time. Can we use the theory from the time-independent system? We use an approach similar to hyperbolic points, because now the fixed points are instantaneous, because the fixed point move in time. How we know the separate lines divide regions of different motion, we measure the stretching using Lyapunov exponents, more precisely using Finite-Size Lyapunov exponents. The Finite-Size Lyapunov exponent is given by this formula. And we compute the time needed for two particles initially separated, this delta naught, to get separate this final distance, delta f. So we fix delta f and delta naught. and we compute this tau, the time. The first and the Lyapunov exponent depend on the position and depend on the time. It's important to note that this delta naught is the spatial resolution of the FSLE field. Okay, if we integrate, if we evolve two particles initiated in both sides of the stable manifold, they diverge forward in time. The particle diverges forward in time. And if we evolve two particles initiated in both sides of a stable manifold, they diverge backward in time. If we have a set of tracers close to the unstable manifold, when this tracer reach the unstable manifold, the tracer arrange or align along the unstable manifold like this. It's because the unstable manifold is called a attractive Lagrangian coherent structure, and the stable manifold is called the repelling Lagrangian coherent structure. These theorems, we have no theorems for the Finite-Size Lyapunov exponents, so this consideration are heuristic. And we take theorems because they are available for Finite-Size Lyapunov exponents. This is a simulation using marine flow. We have two sets of tracers. The red one is inside the eddy, and the black one is between two eddies. And if we evolve the system, we see that the red one remains inside the eddy, because around the eddy we have high values of the level of exponents as transport value. The particles cannot cross these manifolds. And the black one is arranged along these manifolds. Okay, this technique, this Finite-Size Lyapunov exponent or finite time, is Lagrangian coherent structure, are already famous. The importance of this application is increasing. There are several publications in the New York Times and the Economist about this application of the Lagrangian coherent structure. So there is people making money with this technique. I think for me it's not very clear to make money, because we are in the new economy crisis. Okay, this is the second part of the talk. I'm going to talk. I saw some application of the FSLE at different spatial scales. First in the coastal scale, at coastal scales. We use data in the south of Mallorca. This is Mallorca. This is the Palma Bay. And we use three different spatial resolutions on the velocity field. One at 1,500 meters, other one at 300 meters, and the other one at 75 meters. This is for the first, for the 1,500 meters. This one is for the 300 meters. This is the first level response, sorry. And this is for using the more finer spatial resolution. We find lines organizing the flow at this small spatial scale. Okay, because the Palma Bay, the diameter of the Palma Bay is 30 kilometers. So we find small lines, small structures.
The third feature is also the Palma Bay. This is the Palma Bay also?
Yes, this is the port.
Is there any measurement of flows in the Palma Bay? Have they been also been measured, the flows in Palma Bay? Because that was modeling, no?
This is this from a simulation of
Yeah, but are there also measured flows in the Palma Bay?
Experimentos hay hechos, medidas
experimentales. I don't know exactly. Yes, I have data from Mayas. But no, but now with this, but not to get find if there is a structure or
the solution is not like this.
This is a movie of the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents using the velocity data at this spatial resolution. And we see the Lagrangian coherent structure depend on time because change in time.
What is the time scale here?
We have two hours.
So the whole movie is 2 hours?
No, the time step is two hours. And the interval is 1 month.
1 month.
Yes. We now focus in the Palma Bay using again the three spatial resolution, and also we find lines organizing the flow in Palma Bay. And then we compute the temporal average of the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent during 1 month, October 28. And we found this area with high mixing, and this mixing activity in this area make us think that they are maybe a quasi persistent Lagrangian coherent structure.
Excuse me, the question of English. You say October 2008.
Yes, this is the.
So this is simulation or data?
Yeah, yes, it's something we can use. It's data from ground model. It's a numerical model. It's hosted with the methodological.
Small set input for
something. Yes.
So, what do they do in the boundaries? I mean, and.
In the wonder,
the floor, and what, I mean, what is that? I mean,
that is bigger model.
Look at
the question. No, question is, what do you do with the model?
It would be interesting if he clarifies a bit what is that. I mean, it looks like real data, but it seems not to be so. It's not clear. So it's a very realistic simulation.
Yes.
Which.
It's not realistic, but it's
too realistic. Well,
I think for me it's very realistic.
So you said it's an operational model. It's a model that used for operations in real time. Is it a 3D oceanic model?
It's 3D.
So it looks realistic because it's operational. It's meant to be so.
Yeah, it's realistic, but it's the integration of the manual stop and posing this equation with the methodological data. But it's not the data from altimetry or this missing activity here in this area makes us think that maybe there is a quasi persistent Lagrangian coherent structure there. And in order to check if there is a structure there, we compute the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent every 2 hours. And we found that the this structure remain 2 days from October 8th to October 11th. So maybe this is a transport barrier. To check this, we evolve two sets of particles in both sides the transport barrier. The transport barrier is here. And we evolve this two set of tracer, and the tracer don't get mixed together in 1 day of simulation. The two tracer remain in both sides of the barrier. Okay.
Is the amount of tracers concerned? Is the amount of tracers concerned? Because it looks like the last picture there is less.
Yeah, because when the tracer reached the beach,
it is the most
Now I show the application of the FSLE at global scale. We use data from JAMSTEC, air simulator. The spatial resolution is 1 over 10 degrees, and the temporal resolution is 1 day. Here I plot the module of the velocity. It's clear the main current, like Curosio, Goldstream, the equatorial current, the circumpolar current. So if we use this data to compute the finite-size Lyapunov exponents, we found lines organized again the fluid at global scale, and we find large structure in the main caverns, the Golfstream, Curosio, again, Guatemala, the Cúmpola, Malvinas, these big eddies. So if we zoom in the North Pacific Ocean, it's more clear to see the lines organizing the flow. The size of these lines is 20 degrees, so it's 2,000 kilometers, so it's a large structure. If we zoom in the South Atlantic Ocean, we found these rings generated by agulhas, these big eddies generated here, and the high activity in the circumpolar current. And we can estimate the velocity of this eddy because this movie is for 1 year, and every eddy moves 30 degrees, so 3,000 kilometers. And we estimate the velocity of these eddies 10 kilometers per day. So it's a important time step. There's a mosquito, but I think. Okay, this is the time evolution of the FSLE. Well, it's a movie, the FSLE. The height value remains the same area in the same areas, okay? In the Curosio, if we compute the temporal average of the FSLE for 1 year, we found that the missing activity is inhomogeneous in the ocean. With high values in the western boundary ocean. Yeah, in the western. Okay. In the circumpolar current. Now we compare the energy spreads, and we compute the time evolution of missing, The missing is the spatial average of the FSLE, okay? And this is the time evolution of this spatial average of the FSLE. And we see that the south hemisphere has is more activity. The south hemisphere has more missile than the north hemisphere. And also we find the seasonal behavior because the north hemisphere has more activity in spring and less activity in autumn. On the contrary, the south hemisphere has less activity in spring and more activity in autumn.
But also the ocean in the south hemisphere is also bigger than in the north hemisphere. So, so if you scale with the size of the ocean.
Yeah, but this is spatial average.
Yeah, but that's a spatial divided, a spatial average, and, but this is the total amount in that point,
Yeah, but you have, even if the area is larger in the south hemisphere, you have low value for the spatial average.
Okay, now, what's the definition of mixing?
Mixing is the spatial average of the FSLE. Now we compare the oceans. We compute the probability distribution of function of the FSLE for the North Pacific, the Pacific, the Atlantic, and the Indian and the Southern Ocean. The Southern Ocean is the Antarctic. The shape of the PDFs is broad and asymmetric, okay? And the, we found high values of the PDF for high values of the PDF for low values of the Lyapunov exponent, so less missing for the South Pacific, and we found high values. The higher values of the PDF and high values of the Lyapunov exponent, so more activity for the southern ocean. It's more clear here where we plot the time evolution of the missing measure. And this line is for the southern ocean, so it's the ocean which has more activity. And these two lines, the black and the red one, is for the Pacific Ocean, which have less missing activity. Now we compare the main oceanic currents. The PDFs put into two groups. Okay, it's more clear here in the time evolution of the missing measure. Where the west boundary current group make one group with high missing, and the east boundary currents are in another group with low missing. Okay. Now I want to talk about the application of the Lagrangian diagnosis in the Balearic Sea at mesoscale. We use data from the DieCast model. The spatial resolution of this model is 1 over 8 degree, and we integrate this equation of motion, where this is the latitude coordinate, lambda is the latitude coordinate, and t is the time. It's important to note that this capital delta naught is the spatial resolution of the velocity field. Okay, this is the FSLE backward in time, and this is forward in time. Here we use the original spatial resolution of the velocity field, capital delta naught equal 1 over 8 degrees. And the spatial resolution of the FSLE is 1 over 64 degrees. Here we plot together these two FSLE, backward and forward.
How much is that in meters or kilometers?
Sorry?
How much is delta naught in meters or kilometers?
How much? 1 over 64 degrees.
Meters.
Uh, Okay, 1 degree is 100 kilometers. here we have the red lines are the stable manifolds, and the blue lines are the unstable manifolds. The point where this manifold goes are the hyperbolic points, is where the mixing is maximum. We form this mesoscale eddy or subfilament structure. So we found a structure below of the velocity resolution. This is the evolution of the structure in the Balearic Sea. They change in time. You can see how the eddies. How the eddies is broken here, or the barriers, the structure. Now we use the definition given by the video, that. Of the mixing measure. M plus is the spatial average of the forward of the spatial average of the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent forward in time. N minus is the spatial average of the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent forward in time. And N plus minus is the spatial average of the root square of the forward times, and if we compute the temporal evolution of these three quantities, we observe that the three quantities give the same information. So in the follow, we just use the n minus, the spatial average of the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponent backward in time. Here, in this figure, I plot the time evolution of this mixing measure for the Balearic Sea in black, and for the Mediterranean Sea in red. We observe that the Balearic Sea has maximum mixing in spring and summer, and minimum activity in winter. And also, we observe that. The Balearic Sea has more activity in summer than the Mediterranean Sea. So it's comparative study.
Ismael, knowing nothing about that, I would imagine that in summer the sea is more or less calm, you go swimming, and there is no mixing. And in winter there are storms and waves and things. And you are telling me that this is the other way around. And my common sense is completely wrong.
Yeah, but no, why? But it's maybe the weather is
warm,
but the ocean.
Yeah, because you are counting with the surface only. But you have to count with the whole sea, with the three dimensions. Maybe the inner part moves more with hot than with
yes, cold. And the peak of the missing is in spring, where the weather is changing.
So it's that spring and the minimum is at autumn, but there is the biggest summer storm and storms in the Mediterranean.
This is an important point that you are not calculating this from the DieCast model. The DieCast model is forced with it's called the climatological forcing, that means it's the average. So it's the average winds of every year. So I don't know what will happen when we're forcing with the storms. It's different when you one goes to the sea where see very small scales, so 1 kilometer around you. computing this in the space of mesoscale of 100 kilometers. So perhaps our intuition is not necessarily related to what this thing will detect. But it should be said that the forcing in this case is not completely realistic. It's some average force.
So you are blaming the climatological model.
So which is the link?
So you have to
later on, and doesn't correspond to this thing.
So also, if I see the graph, I see that in January it's cold and there's not much mixing, but then in spring, there's the temperature rises, and there's then more heat transfer and more convection. Then everything's going to start to mix. So it's not good.
There was another question. Which is the nature of these covers that you measure the planet size Lyapunov spot? So that covers that flow, where does it come from? Is it from wind forcing, is it from saline concentration, is it from temperature gradients? Well, so which are the ingredients that goes the pH that's for which is
the for the DieCast model take the wind.
Only winds.
I don't know winds it's a mainly what
but my point is here that I look at the sea from my house. And now he knows that everything is calm and there are no plastic bottles and everything. By the end of September or October, everything mixes and there's a lot of rubbish coming.
This is another important point that and I think this should be also said is that the mixing here is defined only as horizontal mixing. So it should be put on the slide. So it's horizontal mixing, so only the horizontal. The model itself is three-dimensional, but you are really computing the currents in one layer, so this can be different from what happens in the vertical. This is not quantified.
But it's horizontal where? Horizontal in the surface?
Yeah.
16. I thought it was a mix of the three.
And you use only one variable, the velocity only one thing.
It's trajectory of something.
This definition of mixing realistic in terms of 3D model that mixes of bacteria and things like that? Because I guess this is a diagnosis of mixing, but you can.
Yeah, this is a diagnosis in 2D.
Right. Is it realistic? Is this 2D or 2D realistic?
And this definition is spatial related, the Finite-Size Lyapunov Exponents, but here it's just in 2D. You can apply this definition in 3D.
Right, no, what I'm saying is we're trying to interpret this approximation, this diagnosis to real world, looking outside the window of things. So maybe the 2D approximation is not applicable in this. I mean, maybe real mixing that you can get from the model probably, this 2D approximation does not.
Yeah, of course, but I think this is first approximation to the existing. Now we have to go to the 3D version.
No, but in the model, you know how many particles go out of that way. And you take away the total model, no? And you look at how the particles move in that way. But since the model has the three dimensions, from time to time, one of those particles might go out of that way. And you might know how much of those particles. I mean, if 1%, 10%, or 1 in 4 million.
So that's also what we suppose that the flow in, that would be the flow move in 2D.
Because what do you say that this is
bigger? The movement, the motion in 3D is larger than in the
You still have a measure. If you start with 100 particles in different places, you still have a measure of how many of them went out of that layer after the simulation time.
Well, at least you can parameterize it with particle velocities in the model.
Yeah, but you can estimate that. I mean, you start with that. I mean, you put 100 particles in this die-cast model. You start the simulation, the model is 3D. So you put a layer number 5, whatever. After a given time, you know how many of those 100 particles remain in layer number 5. So how many?
Don't remember.
They give additional information of oceanographic interest. This is like scales, and they reveal oceanic structures below the resolution of the velocity field. And they are a natural framework to study the interaction of hydrodynamic structure. But really, this third property is true. They reveal oceanic structure below the resolution of the velocity field or introduce artifacts in the results. What happens when the FSLE field is computed below the spatial resolution of the velocity field? Is some artificiality introduced? Now we analyze the, to answer this question, we analyze the scaling properties of the FSLE. Okay, we have is notice to, we have two types of grid, one for the initial position of the particles in the presentation of the FSLE, and the other one of the spatial resolution of the velocity field. This is this delta dot is. For the spatial resolution of the FSLE, and this capital delta node is the spatial resolution of the velocity data. If now we increase the we get finer the spatial resolution of the FSLE field from 1 over 8 degree to 1 over 64 degree, we improve the identification of the structure. Now we have new lines below the these bigger structures. Okay, and we compute at the same spatial resolution of the velocity field at the original spatial resolution, 1 over 8 degrees. So, okay, well, we we can improve the identification of the structure. So now we compute the probability distribution function of the FSLE at these different scales. And when the spatial resolution gets finer, the PDF narrows and the peak increase. This scale behavior suggests a multifactorial character, different scaling occur at different points, which organize in manifold at different dimensions. To check this, we propose this relationship where this P is the maximum value of the PDF, this D is the dimension of the embedding space, 2 in our case is 2 because we analyze in 2 dimensions, the surface, and this capital D is the fractal dimension. From this equation, one obtains this one, the plot of the fractal dimension here shows a collapse of the different spatial scales, confirming the hypothesis in this equation. Thus, a constant interface, interface at the constant value of Lagrangian exponents with a multifactor hierarchy. So, as invariant scale property is present in the finite-size Lyapunov exponents. This is another question about the scaling. What happens if the spatial resolution of everything data is decreasing? Can we recover the structure? Okay, as I said, the spatial resolution of the DieCast model is 1 over 8 degree, and to simulate a resolution loss of the velocity field, we replace a square of made of 4 points with a single point with the value of the velocity is the average of these 4 points. If we do this procedure, we obtain this spatial resolution of the velocity field, and if we repeat this procedure, we obtain this spatial resolution of the velocity field. And this plot the new quasar velocity field. Now we compute the FSLE using this new quasar spatial resolution of the velocity field, and we observe that this is for the original, this is for the 1 over 4 degree, and this is for the half degree. We see that we lost the smaller structure here. We lost here in this new resolution. The structure are smoother now. However, the high values of the FSLE and the main structure remain when we decrease the spatial resolution of the velocity field. Now I analyze the resolution of FSLE when we introduce noise in the computation of the FSLE. First, we perturb the velocity data by introducing a small random number in the original velocity. So we have the new velocity is the original one plus the original one times the relative side alpha times a Gaussian random number with mean 0 and variance 1. Now we compute the FSLE alpha equals 0, so without noise, alpha equals 2, alpha equals 6, and alpha equals 10. Even for alpha equals 10 times the with the perturbation equal to 10 times the velocity data, the structure look the same. Now, in order to quantify the effect of the perturbation of the data, we compute the relative error on the perturbed FSLE respect to the unperturbed FSLE at a given distance, right? And we make an average using 100 Hernández, and even for a relative size of the perturbation equal to 10, the relative error is smaller than 0.2. So even for different sorts of correlated and uncorrelated noise, the FSLE are robust. Finally,
you have just stated, so the finite size level of exponents are robust.
Are robust.
How do you know? How do you know it is the exponents and not the data?
Okay.
I mean, your conclusion is a property of this quantity or a property of the data that you analyze?
The property of the finite size level of exponents.
How do you know? I mean, you change the data? You define a quantity and test in a given set of data. Then the conclusion applies to the data or to the definition?
Using this data, but I can check using all the data.
What I'm asking is if your conclusions are a conclusion on the data or on these quantities. So it's a problem of principle. Okay.
Is robust? The final side is robust using this data, introducing the perturbation in the data.
I think that the conclusion is that it's on the measurement, not on the data. The point being that, for example, if you drop half of the data, or 75% of the data, you still recover the same indicator. This is what he showed previously. So that's a robustness of the indicator rather than on the data.
You wonder whether it depends on data at all.
Whether
it depends on the data.
Yeah.
And with this variant, you have the same number multiplied by 10.
Yes.
It's none. It has nothing to do with the
data.
Yeah,
it's the sign of the
perturbation. I wouldn't call
perturbation
just the 10 as the main number. It's not perturbation.
It's
not enough.
Should
be
not
enough. But it's not robust.
The relative size times the observable number. So this is not first part. It's a just a random number because I compute for uncorrelated noise in space and time, uncorrelated noise in space, uncorrelated in time, correlated in time, and correlated in space.
The thing is that the average, so this is not the temporal average of this remains the previous one. So say how the measure is feeling the data at all. So it's related to the average of the data, is or insensitive to details or to change the perturbation.
Okay. Finally I analyze the noise in the particles trajectories. This is a simple way to include and resolve small scales in the computation of SLE. We introduce in the equation of motion this stochastic curve. We introduce this stochastic term in the equation of motion This is Gaussian white noise, and this capital D is the diffusivity given by the Okubo's formula. The Okubo's formula relates the spatial scale with the diffusion. Compute trajectories of five particles without noise and with noise, we see that they are very different, really very different. Now we compute the FSLE, introducing the adding these noise in the particle trajectories, using the diffusivity corresponding to the DieCast model, this one. We obtain this structure, and this one is without noise. We can see that the mesoscale structure remains with the diffusivity introduced. And this one is only to see what happened with diffusivity and the structure are destroyed. This is the conclusion. Increasing the spatial resolution of the FSLE, we improve the identification of surface mesoscale structures. The main surface mesoscale structure in the ocean remains when the spatial resolution of the event data decreases. The spatial distribution of FSLE displays a multifractal character. The FSLE are rather robust. And mesoscale structure are maintained when the diffusion is included.
Let me come back to the comparison of the model with reality. What is the possibilities to get there on that? Because in particular, seeing the influence of the diffusive noise that you showed, knowing that certainly that there will be diffusive noise in the real system, is there a way to monitor the real flows? For example, I thought of are there any satellite images where you can trace within the infrared the temperature differences, at least on the surface, or color analysis, where you may see neutrons? Or do you have any data available to compare your data to experiments or to images?
Okay, yes, but I have, for instance, data from other regions.
But it would be important information to know to what really scale do you need to go in your model to still have a realistic description of the flow. So at what scale does it make sense, or which scales make sense to include in the model?
You use the data you have, so this data have a resolution, but we, in this work, we, for instance, in altimetry, have